Hello everybody, I'm Rene Ramos, director of the Lynn and Lewis Wolfson II Florida Moving Image Archives, and this is Rewind, the show that looks back on Florida's past with historic film and video. It's time for another trip back into the past, so sit back, relax, and enjoy another episode of Rewind.
I'm going to go to the next one. interchange, but will have on and off ramps and complete free movement of traffic for all movements in every direction at this point.
How many such exits like that will you have?
Oh, we'll have quite a number. Of course, we'll have one at 36 feet, one at 46, one at 54, an overpass at 62nd, and another interchange at 75th Street, and a number more for the north end.
But you will have no interchange or intersection as such for you, where two roads will cross?
No, there'll be a complete separation of traffic once you get on this highway. You can ride uninterrupted by any traffic lights or cross traffic. It's a completely limited access highway.
That's how the Paris Expressway system looks from the air. Back with us tonight is the man who designed the master plan for that system. He's Wilbur Smith, nationally recognized highway traffic engineer from New Haven, Connecticut. Well, Mr. Smith, it's been 4 years now since you presented your recommendations concerning an expressway system for Dade County. How do you think we've progressed here?
Strike, I think you've made remarkable progress. In fact, I don't know of any city that's moving faster at the moment than the Miami area in developing an expressway program. Unfortunately, 4 years ago, you were much behind other cities, even cities of comparable size. And so you need to keep up this rapid pace if you're going to catch up and even move ahead or begin to meet the needs.
I know, Mr. Smith, you're familiar with road problems in other areas of the country. What seems to be the major difficulty with regard to making utilization of the federal interstate highway money?
I think one of the main difficulties in this area, as well as in other areas of the country, is that the cost of these urban roads are exceeding the estimates, and the monies that are available are not producing the mileage that has been hoped for when the roads were planned. And because of the very high cost of developing urban expressways, most of the cities and in all of the states, I think we find a problem similar to yours in Florida and Dade County, and that is that we are not getting along as fast as we need to in order to take care of the condition which already exists, but we're not able to build a road because of the high cost as fast as they are needed to accommodate the very rapidly mushrooming traffic demand.
It's great competition in the country for this available.
Great competition, and it has to be spread over a great amount of mileage.
Do you think the expressway, Mr. Smith, is the answer to the ills of modern congested traffic?
Well, we've always said, Mr. Rank, that we believe that urban expressways are the only answer to our transportation problems. This is particularly true if we're going to properly plan and properly protect our built-up areas, particularly the central and core districts. I don't know any way in which we can really do a good job of maintaining the stability of these areas and providing the proper economic balance except to provide the citizens rapid and efficient transportation. And in Miami, as well as in most other cities, transportation that is preferred is by automobile, and this, in our way of thinking, requires expressway.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. We will be talking with you later on in the program. But now let's take a look at where the funds come from for the projects we've been talking about and see. The 36-feet tollway was financed partially through a bond issue, partly from funds from the federal government. The Palmetto Bypass is being built with primary and secondary road funds from the state. The North-South Expressway is
of this bond issuance to enable us to keep up the momentum that we have developed in building this expressway system so that we might be able to complete it by 1966 instead of 1972 or thereafter, according to the present schedule.
Just what will this bond issue cost? $46 million.
This bond issue will specifically enable us to build a facility beginning at the southernmost point of the interstate highway system at 32nd Road near the Rickenbacker Causeway and moving north from there across the Miami River on two fixed span bridges and then into a separation and distribution of the traffic with one leg of it going into DuPont Plaza area and another leg moving along the Miami River under the First Street Bridge and under a new Tiger Street Bridge. That will be part of this program. That's the specific things that will be done with the proceeds of this bond issue.
I believe, Mr. Secretary, with current revenue available, the expressway will be constructed from the Golden Glades Interchange down to about 29th Street.
That's right.
You just told us that the expressway bond issue will pay for the construction of the expressway from roughly 2nd Street over the Miami River down to the entrance of Rickenbacker Causeway. That still leaves one gap to be completed. And why are you building the tail end of the expressway first? Why not continue right on down to 29th Street?
We could not continue from 29th Street south without throwing too much traffic into the central area. We're not prepared to handle this traffic until we solve these bottlenecks in this congested area. The principal bottleneck being our ability to get across the river both north and south and east and west, and also to keep the traffic that wants to go through from interfering with the traffic that wants to shop there or park there in that area. And in doing this, therefore, it's logical for us to do this part first. Then we can start moving from 29th Street south.
When do you think the entire expressway will be completed if this bond issue passes and will be rideable?
If this bond issue passes, we will be able to complete this entire interstate system as well as the rest of the expressway by 1966 because we will use the funds that will be allocated to us in the future years towards the completion of this thing. And then after that, we'll use the funds allocated to us for the retirement of these boats.
A $40 million change to the bond issue goes for the expressway. Could you explain some of the projects to be built for the other $6 million?
The other $6 million of projects that do not qualify for federal aid. Primarily, it's the Tiger Street Bridge, which goes for about $2 million of this. And then there are a number of other projects throughout all parts of the county, making up the other $4 million.
In a word, Mr. Singer, can you explain why we need this expressway money now?
We need this expressway money now because to make this a usable and reliable facility, it would take some $45 or $50 million. With our income being about $10 million a year, if we started this based on our income and stage construction, we would have this area ripped up for a period of about 5 years. Now, the other way we could do it would be to sit back and wait for 5 years' funds to accumulate. And of course, with the pressures on us for money, it's quite illogical that we could be able to do so.
The Center State Expressway System will be a free road, Mr. Center.
That's right. There'll be no tolls on any part of the interstate highway system.
Well, we've seen the problem that they face concerning its road building program. Recognizing the problem, though, is half the job. We have the tools and manpower to follow through with the expressway plan. What we don't have is the money to finance it. We can't solve the problem with mirrors or a tricky slogan. Construction costs money. What does private industry do when faced with a need for expansion? Honest about what it doesn't do. It doesn't proceed on a pay-as-you-go basis. Instead, it issues securities or borrows the capital and builds its own extensions or expansion property. Why not use the same principle to build our roads? Many don't want to because they say the expenditure of public money means taxes. Well, let's face it, you just don't get something for nothing these days. You pay for everything, but if you shop right, you can get good value. Bargains. The big question is, and the only one that should concern us when buying something, be it a pair of shoes or a superhighway, is how much will it cost? The more important is it worth it? Some 85,000 day freeholders will answer that last question May 3rd when they vote on the $46 million bond issue.
$1 a quarter per year for about 10 or 11 years until these bonds are paid off. If he had a loan that cost $18,000, he would be paying approximately 2 cents a day. If he had a loan that cost $26,000, he would be paying approximately 4 cents a day for that same period of time.
Was this tax a permanent one?
No, this tax is not a permanent tax. This is a tax to service this bond issue to pay the interest and principal on these bonds. And according to our present schedule, this would be paid off in full by 1971, after which this tax would cease. And it would be impossible for the county commission or anyone else to continue it without another freeholder's election authorizing it.
The federal government is going to pay back the principal sum on the expressway. Do we have any guarantee, Mr. Sager, that the federal government, for Uncle Sam, is going to give us back the money?
We have a commitment of the federal government to build this interstate highway program. They're giving us allocations each year. We have some $118 million still coming to us. We expect to use the money coming in the years 1961 to 1967 for additional construction. We have agreed with the Bureau of Roads that in 1968, they will return $10 million and $10 million each year after the last payment being in 1971.
Thank you, Mr. Singer. Now we see what it would cost us. Doesn't seem like an awful lot to pay for a $46 million road program. If there's some to say they can't even afford an extra 2 or 4 cents a day in taxes. What these people don't realize is they're getting perhaps the biggest 2 cent per day bargain in history. Just what would we get for our money? Let's take a look. The Automotive Safety Foundation report shows that a motorist saves 2 cents per mile in the cost of operating his car by traveling on expressways rather than on city streets. Then consider the safety aspect. Expressways have been proven to be 5 times safer than regular roads. There are less accidents. And in coincidence with this, the less accidents, the lower the cost of automobile insurance. But perhaps the biggest feature of all is the saving of nerves and time. Every evening, the sun setting in the west means just one thing to thousands of the Italians. The end of a long and sometimes hard day at the office. The most difficult and most trying time of all is just beginning. It's that drive home. In a word, it's immense. One of the biggest rush hour traffic bottlenecks can be seen in the Brickell Avenue Bridge. No one knows that story better than the state traffic engineer George Cundy, who has this report for us.
Yes, traffic is still bad. In fact, it's getting worse every day. This area is considered a top cloud going across the Brickell Avenue Bridge south. It is undoubtedly one of the worst bottlenecks we have, not only in Dade County, but probably in all of Southeast Florida. We've done everything that we can do to solve this thing. We have electronic signals in, full electronic frames. We have new wide streets south of the bridge to accept the traffic. We even have police standing there directing the traffic and attempting to push it through the intersection, which still would work. The only way that we can move more traffic immediately for all people is to build expressways that are truly designed to move traffic, not to hold it up. Now, certainly, this is not a 24-hour situation as far as this type of congestion is concerned. However, when this congestion does let up, then the bridges are allowed to open, and if we have those types of congestion, then we'll last on to the evening traffic. In fact, when our bridges are not open and closing from one thing or another, they're probably stuck in an open position where nobody can use it at all. The only way we can actually go ahead and solve these problems is to build a permanent facility that's meant to move cars and move vehicular traffic, and not to stall it. We suggest, of course, expressways are the ultimate solution to our traffic problem.
A major bond issue would give us such an expressway. What if the bond issue doesn't pass? How big a setback would it mean for Dave's road program? Mr. Singer, do you have an answer for that one?
If the bond issue doesn't pass, we'll have to stop our planning for the time being for anything south of 29th Street. And when we'll pick that up again, I don't know. We're probably running the risk of a lot of additional buildings going into the back of our right-of-way. And with the criteria of the Bureau of Roads changing, it's doubtful as to when we can move south of 29th Street.
Mr. Singer, yesterday when Governor Collins was in town, he took him on a tour of the expressway system. Let's listen now to your conversation with the governor.
Governor, we're standing here underneath this gigantic structure of the people. We will back you up on that. You give them the facts and let them understand it. And I just believe that the fine and progressive spirit of this community will back you.
Glad we were talking about expressways. People overall running right through the heart of the city. One really has to stretch his imagination to visualize what Miami will look like in the not too distant future. But to help us out, we have before us in the studio a giant model of the city of Miami, constructed through a joint effort of the city and the metro planning departments. According to the planners, this is what your city is supposed to look like in 1985. Let's say I noticed that expressways seem to rain the central business area here.
Yes, sir, this is the east-west expressway, which would come from the MacArthur Causeway Bridge and go over Biscayne Boulevard and over the railroad tracks and into the 36th Street and 7th Avenue interchange.
Let's walk around the side of the model until we get to the downtown bridge area. Now, this is something in the realm of reality. This is the project, isn't it, Mr. Singer? It's included in the bond issue on May 3rd.
That's right. This is the North-South Expressway. This is the Flagler Street Bridge, and we propose to build everything from here south to 32nd Road out of the proceeds of this bond issue.
Well, this expressway comes down alongside the Miami River and expands over southwest to 2nd Avenue, and this is a giant interchange here near the bridge.
That's right. This is our downtown interchange, one leg of it going into the DuPont Pass area, and the other leg going over these high-level bridges and heading south.
Mr. Smith, I noticed the road goes out on the other side there near Biscayne Bay. Is this part of your design plan for Miami?
Yes, we feel an automobile will have to circumvent the downtown area, as the planners have indicated here, with some type of road along the edge of the bay. Of course, this could be developed in stages, and I believe the initial stage would simply carry the expressway down into the Biscayne Boulevard area, and the bay loop would come at a later date.
Mr. Singer, this road comes right through downtown, goes out to the south end of town. This points up perhaps the fact that the expressway system just isn't for the convenience of people who work downtown. Tell us how it would serve the entire county.
This would serve the entire county by the fact that the people going from Miami Beach, for example, to Coral Gables, or from North Miami to South Miami, they would take some of these expressway routes and avoid the congestion of the downtown area, the traffic in downtown area, and go on a completely limited access facility from wherever they begin to wherever they go without, and avoid all that trouble that they now have in the central area.
Could you tell us, Mr. Smith, what it's like to ride on one of these completed facilities?
What can the people of Miami look forward to when they can get on their into their automobiles and ride on the expressway?
As we pointed out in our earlier discussions, and I think it is apparent from the model, these expressways are built without intersections at grade. They are designed for high safe speeds, design speeds of 60 miles an hour, but operating speeds somewhat less than that, of course, so that with continuity of speed and with the safety factors involved, the travel will be much improved over congested streets.
Well, that gives you a picture of Miami of the future. Much of the progress of the city and the county is dependent on the movement of traffic about the area. You've seen and heard the story of the shortest distance, the story of Miami's expressway bond issue. And you've seen in this model an inkling of what the expressways will look like. The voters of this city and county, property holders who have re-registered for the bond election May 3rd, have the opportunity, a unique one, to bring us out of the doldrums and small-town thinking and help us emerge onto the road of the future with a modern plan of expressways to benefit all areas of Dade County. We strongly urge a yes vote on the May 3rd expressway bond issue. Let's help Greater Miami, a great area, today to become even greater tomorrow. Good night.
WTVJ News has presented The Shortest Distance, a special report on Miami's expressway system and the May 3rd expressway bond issue. The Shortest Distance was written by Dave Choate. Film editor, Joe Martinez. your narrator, Ralph Rennie. This program was directed by Martin Saxon.
That's about it for this edition of Rewind. Just time to remind you that Rewind features historical film and video from the Lynn and Lewis Wolfson II Florida Moving Image Archives. To see more from the Wolfson Archives collections, visit our website, wolfsonarchives.org. You can search the archives catalog and watch video online. And be sure to connect to our YouTube channel, where you will find hundreds of carefully curated clips, or link to the Wolfson Archives Facebook page to keep up with our busy calendar of historical happenings. Until next time, I'm Rene Ramos. Thanks for watching.